Assistant Professor at Jail Bajaj Institute of Management and Research. I feel highly delighted to welcome today Mr. Anupam Arora ji, Chief Operating Officer, Bharti Airtel Limited. I also welcome Dr. Ajay Kumar sir, Director, Jail Bajaj Institute of Management and Research, all the faculty members and their students on this very special expert talk series on achieving operational excellence during COVID-19. Would take the opportunity to introduce our expert guest of the day, Mr. Anupam Arora ji. He brings over 20 years of telecom experience with business development, operations management, consumer experience, and network operations in Bharti Airtel Limited. He was also involved in designing and developing customer services and experience strategies, defining customer communication strategy across customer life cycles. He was also Vice President Sales and Marketing, Delhi Media, and he is alumnus of IIM Bangalore. Very warm welcome, sir. Would also like to give brief introduction of Dr. Ajay Kumar sir, Director, JLBIMR. He has been serving education industry for more than 32 years through teaching, research, training and consultancy. In past, he served as Director of Management at ITS, Mohan Nagar Asian School of Media Studies, Marwai Studio and many more. He has been active in national and international projects and conducted more than 600 seminars and conferences. Under his leadership, JLBIMR is currently involved in multiple the distribution of food and clothes to needy people in amidst COVID-19. Now, I would request Director Sir to please proceed with the
good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
On behalf of JLBIMR Institute of Management and Research, I extend my warm welcome to Mr. Anupam Arora, and I again I feel obliged for his time which he has spared for the students and faculty members to deliberate on very pertinent topic, though operational excellence during COVID-19. All of you know that more than 6 months have passed and the entire industry, because of the lockdown, because of impact upon manufacturing, because of the impact upon entire supply chain, it has been widely affected. Recent report suggests that the global growth rate might be to the level of 2.8%. So not many challenges are there. Though topic is about operational excellence, I don't know whether anyone is going to try for operational excellence or all the companies will try only to maintain the level of operations satisfactory. Because in any functional activities during this particular period or even post-COVID, because it has impacted the entire population across the globe, it's very difficult to say that in any field or any management activities or practices, there will be level of excellence. But yes, whatever we do, if we are going to do the things effectively and efficiently, we can call it excellence, but under the COVID conditions. All of you know that the world's global supply chain has been dramatically altered in recent months as the effect of novel coronavirus. It has wreaked havoc on world economies, both large and small. This unprecedented disruption to end-to-end global supply chain presents a lasting threat to both current response efforts and an organization's ability to sustain future operations. So as I told you, challenges is of sustainability. Dear students, during last session also I had talked about the VUCA. So VUCA is everywhere. If we talk about volatility, it is there. It is there in the case of operations also. Uncertainty is also there. So there are many challenges related with the operational responsibility of the organization. Somewhere you will find that the stocks have piled up. Somewhere for some item you may find that the stocks are not there. Under many product categories, the transportation or stock requirement may be felt very urgently for the reason that there are several products whose shelf life remain very short. Specifically, if we are talking about the food items or grains or fruits or vegetables or for that matter medicines, etc., or cold drinks, etc., there are many, many other products also. So challenges are multiplying every day. So all the organizations are required to perform a supply chain risk assessment, and they are required to evaluate the feasibility or possibility to have proper supply chain. Even the companies are also required to look upon optimization of production and distribution, and they must look to secure distribution logistics. I know that you must be very much inquisitive to listen to our esteemed guest. The topic is very interesting, very important, and I believe that our guest will be able to throw light on some of the areas, I will say, some of the areas, because the deliberation, if truly happens on this subject, it may be for a week or so, because World Bank and other government organizations globally, they have been talking on this subject or discussing on this subject or collecting data but related with this subject for last many months. Recently, World Bank has come up with the report of July also. So without wasting much of your time, I would like to request the guest to start this session. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable thoughts. Indeed, you highlighted a lot of important areas regarding operational excellence. I would now request our guest, Anupam Arora ji, to please start the session.
Very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Ajay. I'm so feeling privileged in terms of giving this opportunity to share my experience and what is happening. Also, I would like to thank Professor Atul, who has given this opportunity of inviting here and really bringing on the table what we have been facing from the last 5 or 6 months. To complement this statement of Mr. Ajay Kumar, I think he used a very right word, VUCA, which is the volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. We all have been facing this, and neither we have seen this kind of a situation earlier. Let me give you a little bit background about what I do, and then we will build up onto the topic. I work with Bharti Airtel. So I've been a long veteran in Bharti and spent quite a bit of time in telecom. For you, it may be a telecom company, but we are a network service provider. When we look at the last 4 months, 19th of March, the government decided in terms to, you know, having a lockdown for a day, and post that, the lockdown got extended for a span of 30 days, then 60 days, and then it went to 90 days. COVID-19 has created a massive humanitarian challenge. Billions ill, hundreds of thousands of life, soaring unemployment rates. In the world's most robust economies, today food banks stretched beyond capacity. Governments are strained to deliver critical services. The pandemic is a challenge for not only for businesses, it has forced an abrupt dislocation of how all we work. Also, how customers behave. We all are customers to a particular, the economy. The way of buying and the way what we would go and shop has changed. The supply chain function, even the normal way of working has been disrupted, and ultimately constituting and impacting the business performance. So that is the kind of turbulence we all are facing. And when I said I work with a telecom company, the first biggest challenge for all of us at the organization was how to keep the lights on. When I say how to keep the lights on, when you were not going to the market, I was not going to the market, the only way of communication was telecom. Digital services available at home, entertainment through TV, communication through your mobile services. The first thing which was really ringing for us day and night, how do we ensure our network availability and uptime? And which was a very, very, very big task for us. Thousands of engineers, thousands of our vendors are from Ericsson to Nokia to Huawei to Ciena, all were on streets ensuring that network availability is there for each and every person sitting at home. Then the lockdown, where the government had not given permission for entering into many of the districts. The permissions being taken from the government, the diesel filling of the sites when the electricity goes off, the engineers visiting containment areas, the safety and security which was like a sword hanging on our head for our employees who are going in the field, the fear of getting infected for an engineer, for a salesperson, were all something which we all were thinking 24 hours. When I look back, many of us were sitting at home and really enjoying that, yes, the network of mobile is coming. I have a broadband available. But there is a thousands of force and people who have been really worried and thinking that how we provide the connectivity, how we keep the light on. When I say light on, it is the signals coming there. That is the kind of turbulence, that is the kind of challenge, that is the kind of uncertainty we have been facing from March. Moreover, we have been in a habit where we would come to an office. Now, when the offices are closed, how do we really come back to our normal way of working? The change of working. In a span of 10 days, I think as an organization, we a step in terms to creating IDs so that people can work from home. And then step by step, we built it. So these were the COVID times. Now coming back to the topic, I think Dr. Saab said very, very critical points. If one has to really think over that, it can be minutes of hours of conversation what we can have. When I look at that topic, it says operational excellence. The first two words are operational excellence. For us, it is two words. But when we come to the corporate world or the way onto the ground, operational excellence, there are books which are written, but operational excellence requires lot of planning, designing, crafting your strategy that how you would build on it. I would also put up one or two slides that what I look at operational excellence. How do we look at really, you know, giving and bringing value to that, so that what I speak can you can actually really club it together. Can I share? Can you allow me to share my slide?
Abhinji, is it allowed?
No, it's not allowed. It says just post disabled participant screen sharing.
Okay. Robinji, can you allow it?
Sir, can allow this.
Okay. Director, sir, can I request you to allow?
Okay, by the time you allow, I can go ahead with that. So coming back, what is operational experience? In a simplified way, if I would have to talk, so you all would be studying that. In every business, there is one area which can be improved. How meaningful that is when you have to change. So change itself is a very big word. Sometimes it happens major initiatives, which can be where you are trying to disrupt where we are working or maybe a total upheaval in the business. But most of the time, change happens in a much less overt way, happens slowly and gradually. But what we are seeing right now is a change which is actually happening extremely fast. So operational excellence for us is an example of change. Operational excellence can also be described as a philosophy that embraces problem solving and leadership as the key key for improvement. For many people, operational excellence is a difficult term. People are unsure how to define it. But when we look at simply operational excellence, however, is not a set of activities that you perform. It is more a mindset that should be within you and your employees.
Sir, you can share now. You are the co-host.
Okay.
It's coming, sir.
Yeah. So when I talk about operational excellence, you know, we typically look at the four pillars. One is the strategy deployment. Second is in terms of high performing work teams. Third is performance management. And the last is process excellence. So when you would look at what I'm going to say to you from a strategy deployment, it is aligning your business strategy and the way you execute. Operational excellence would only give you the best results when you execute well. Operational excellence is a mindset that embraces certain principles and tools to create sustainable improvement within an organization. And this happens to high performance work teams. Right attitude, right mindset, right competencies. Then your performance management, how you look at your KPIs, what are you looking at, what are your measurables, what are your objectives, and what are your goals. Last is your process excellence, which is well-designed support process and value chain. So one has to really look at the backward integration with the forward integration. The teams at the front, if not supported well, would not be able to give you the performance what you're looking for. It has to be seamless. And so, in a nutshell, operational excellence, the journey that involves applying right tools to to the right process. When this happens successfully, the ideal work culture is created, where employees are provided in a way that enables them to stay empowered and motivated. There are many ways of looking at operational measuring. Many ways of measuring operational experience. There is lean manufacturing, Six Sigma, Kaizen, which you all studied. But when we look from a what is going around us, we never realize that the change would be so fast that we would actually look at really solving the problem quickly to sustain ourselves. Dr. Ajay said, many organizations either would sustain operational excellence or are they going to really excel into the operational excellence? I think that is the question which we or every organization is asking today. Because the complete paradigm, the complete way of working has changed. So just to give an example, when we provide telecom services, it is a network which we maintain. It is also in every tehsil of a state, we would have somebody who's providing or who's fulfilling or supplying the SIMs in the market. Then there are distributors, then there are retailers, then there are some salespeople who would ensure that the stock means the money or the talk time availability is there in the market. And when this happened, everything was disrupted. What changed in COVID-19 for us? The first thing was, there was new ways of working. When I say new ways of working, the teams could not go to the field. We could not communicate to the retailers. Retailers could not do recharges. The consumer was not coming onto the street for getting recharges done. People were not able to pay their mobile bills and they wanted services to be working. There were ways when we worked out that the work from home, our teams would talk to customers on the virtual way, which can be either through mails or calling them. Also, these small shopkeepers across the country or across state were not able to transfer the money to buy the talk time. Those all guys either used Airtel Payment Bank or used NEFT or used digital way of transferring the money to buying the talk time. So it was a complete new way of working for us, which happened virtually. More importantly was that the complete team was really scared that what should they do? Should they go to the market or not? Should they visit the sites? If the fiber cuts were happening, what should they do? We had to really look at the people's safety first. We had to ensure that every team member is carrying sanitizers, is having masks. We have provided adequate stock to each of these people. This changed the way of working. Extensive use of digital, high level of fear and uncertainty, which I talked about. So everything changed for us. And in a span of, I would say 25 to 30 days, we ourselves adopted the new way of working. We really were looking at that, how can we give that comfort? How can we give that understanding? How can we be more digital? How can we be more closer to the market? All these things were the biggest challenges. And lastly, the consumer behavior also changed. People were not going to the market. The market was closed. Still, many people are not going to the market after market opening up. They do recharges through digital platform. We were doing recharges through Airtel Payment Bank Airtel Payment Bank as well as ATMs. Many of the consumers were going to their neighbors and getting the recharges done. This all actually changed the life for us. and people trying day in, day out in terms to really adopting to the new way of working. The important thing during this time is to find, and what we realized and what was our learning was, the important thing during this time and to find the focus was that whatever we are doing, we should do it efficiently. Whatever facilities we have, we should use them judiciously. And at this point of time, there were four pillars which we looked at, that how can we create operational efficiency in this kind of a chaos, in this count, in this kind of a uncertainty. The first was in terms to eliminate silos of chaos, where we were interacting day in and day night with the field team. Create employee accountability. We would always go back to each of the employees and say them, when you are going, do it FTR, first time right. Don't look at that you would get an opportunity again to travel to that place. Third was maximizing resource utilization. Whatever resources were there available for us, we tried and utilized it in a very effective way. Last and the least, I've been talking digital and embracing the complete automation. We worked out complete way of working for each and every employee working from home. Access of all softwares at his home or on his mobile, so that there is no limitation in terms to getting the data. As a senior leader, the biggest challenge for us or the leadership team was, we were not getting the data analysis to look at how things are solving. We used to decide many things on gut feeling, because everything is not available now. You would not be able to go to field. You would not be able to go and work in the market. And decision making extremely was limited in terms to whatever data you have available, whatever KPI you can really look at, and the gut feel and the understanding from the market. How did we react to COVID-19? I said safety first, which was extremely important for our employees. The biggest thing for us and the organization was ensuring that our employees are safe. We used to have morning Zoom calls, cross-functional teams, what support they want, what data they want, how can we enable them more in terms of taking the decision. On ground correction, regular calls with network team. Network was the most important thing for us. Because small, you know, towns, FSCs, our distributor FSCs who were working that were there, they would walk onto the street, not on their bikes, and go to the houses of retailers, or go into small villages where the shopkeepers are open and providing them the SIMs, providing them the recharge was extremely important. The new KPIs were formed. We never looked at the old KPIs, that how many shops you are visiting. We were interacting on phone. The KPIs were how many retailers you have interacted, how many shopkeepers you have provided the money digitally. It was a complete change of paradigm for us. Regular interactions, daily meeting with CEOs, marketing team, network head, that how the KPIs are looking. When all of us were sitting at home, the KPIs were different. The data usage got so much moved that it was very difficult in terms of utilizing the capacity. Where an individual earlier was using 1 GB of data in a day was now using 3 GB of data in a day. Last was motivating the team. Whatever success or failures we had on a day, we ensured one thing, giving a pat to each of the team members who was bold in terms of going in the market bold in terms of sitting at home and really ensuring business is continuing. These were the four pillars what we really looked at. Now, going forward, one of the questions which comes from all of you, would come from all of you and would be on your mind, how we must act now to achieve operational excellence. Things have changed for us in the last 5 months. KPIs have changed. The way of looking at business has got more simpler. We do not really go into analytics very much, but we have really simplified our way of working. We have reevaluated KPIs to focus on sustenance our growth. Got closer to customers through digital channels. When you see the TV today, on the screen of Airtel Digital TV, it comes, aap recharge kaise kare? We are communicating digitally to consumers. Propositions are also based on to how the customer usage has been from last 3 or 4 months. And complete communication has changed. Market assessment on competition strategies has completely changed. And we are now actually de-average markets. The Agra would behave differently because the containment areas were longer, whereas Delhi would behave differently because containment areas grew extremely high. Every behavior, every city, every state has given different kind of experience. Uttarakhand was behaving differently and Kerala was behaving differently. We have completely de-averaged our markets. We have looked at how do we simplify, how do we communicate. Safeguarding employees and finding new ways of working. We have put up really strong team of some people who take care of our employees. We have now doctor on panel. We have somebody who's really looks at, the team and on the ground has sanitizer, have masks. Our offices are getting sanitized on a weekly basis. There's a complete way of working for ensuring that employees are safe. Virtually working is the new way of working. Not every employee comes to office. He's supposed to come once in a week, or if he's coming, he would come for a full week and he would not come next week. So there are team A, team B, which are there. At any point of time, we don't have more than 30% of the strength in office. This is how we are sustaining our business. Last and the least is digitization, automation to create initiatives. Today, consumers of 60 plus or consumers of young age or the consumers across ages are really adapting to digital way of working. If I would have to give an example, before the lockdown, there were only 2 customers who used to their payments through digital way. Today, 8 customers or 9 customers do their payment through digital way. People are fearing to go in the market. And we are going digitized. This is happening across the industry. It is not only for telecom, it is happening your consumer durable, there have proper Zomato, all have actually gone, getting extreme high number of orders on a digital way, and the business is flourishing. Last, automation within the organization. We have really simplified the way of working. Really, really simplified way of working. Everything is available onto his mobile, through apps, and also through the softwares. There is nothing which is now on paper. There is nothing which is there on Excel. You open up an app and you find it. This is how we are actually planning to achieve operational excellence. The last 2 months post the lockdown, unlocking which has happened, when we look at our internal parameters, when we look at the consumer satisfaction, when we look at our own employee satisfaction, I think we are more satisfied. We are more closer to the consumer, and we are far better onto our KPIs. What we started, we are almost at par to the February and January levels. Day in, day out, we are actually reprocessing what we have done. We are reinventing what we have done. And that is step by step, what we are actually creating the operational excellence on. Every team member is coming back to us on a smarter way of doing a particular process. We take the time, we look at it, and we recreate it. This is how we are driving operational excellence. And we are always open and now more closer to employees on taking feedback. This has changed for the life for us. And this is how we look at that going forward for, the time the vaccine does not come. We would actually really keep working. That's how life is going to be. And it's going to be interesting. It has made us so enriched and we are learning on a daily basis how to compete, how to stand into this world. I think doctors have used the real right word for us in the starting. And I'm going to stick to that. This is really VUCA world right now for us. Just to end my conversation, I can pick up with the questions from you. This is how we look at all progress takes place outside the comfort zone. We have been comfortable with the way of working. Today, we are uncomfortable. And that is how we are reinventing. Look at the education, the sector in which you are. Everything is getting onto the virtual world and the comfort zone. We all are out of comfort zone. Everything is virtual. And this is how we are learning day in, day out from consumers like you, from people like you, from young age people like you, trying to learn and walk to survive and excel better into this kind of environment, which is really volatile for us. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much, Anupam ji, for this wonderful PPT. And indeed, you have shared in a very organized manner that what challenges your organization faced, and along with the action plan that you people created and you implemented, try to implement it and take out of as much as you can. Thank you so much for the session. We have a few questions in our chat box. So I would like to take first question from Rishabh Ranjan. He's asking that there's a huge increase in operational cost as well. So how your company is maintaining the national profit? How your company is maintaining that profit? Amid this operational cost.
Yeah, so there are our operational cost today, it would have increased. It has only increased in terms of maintaining network. This is what we are ensuring, and this is a good cost for us. If we can provide great network, great customer experience, and a great network experience, that is a good cost for us because the loyalty of a consumer increases with that. If I would have to look at from an operational cost at the back from a sales or office or other things, it may not have increased. I'm being honest onto that because today consumer has adopted digitally. Retailers have adopted digitally. They are doing ordering to payment transfer all digitally. That is where the cost comes down. And if my network cost increases, I'm fine with that. I am able to provide a good experience to the consumer. Second is from a network point of view also, the cost increases when there are disruption onto the roads, when the fiber cuts happen, or the electricity goes off, or there are different challenges. That has come down. The cost would have cost has gone increased only onto the basis where people are consuming more. And if Going forward, consumption of data and voice is the path forward. We would have to increase the cost. We would have to look at experience, which is fine. We would have to do that. We have also looked at many places where we can save the cost, and there is a complete team which works on how to bring down the cost, smarter way of working, and preventing the wastage. So yes, there is increase of cost, but we are not too really worried. We would actually look at better customer experience, better network experience, than really getting worried onto the cost. Till the time the consumer is onto the network, we are fine with it.
Okay, sir. Next question would be, how do you quantify the cost associated with the operational excellence journey for the budgeting purpose, especially COVID-19?
Every organization would have different cost. The organization which I work with, our 90% cost are network. So if I would have to really put up from a P&L perspective, my 90% cost is network. Network is the product. That is what we look at. Then there is obviously a sales and marketing cost. Taking care of employees is a cost which is always there from an HR perspective. Marketing costs would have come down. So that is there. Third is from a cost from a digitization perspective. These are costs. I would not say these are costs. These are actually the really investment into the business, because when you build up a digital platform, you don't build it up for today, you build it for future. Last is in terms to market servicing costs. They are fine. So we typically look at four ways of cost. Network cost is always weak cost. That's a product cost. So okay, that's how we look at it. Four parts. Yeah.
Sir, one more question. That what is the mode of communication you are using right now for the consumers? I mean, because it's a difficult time that you are not in touch with the directly with the consumers. So how you are ensuring that consumer are getting updated, getting right services?
Okay. So from a digital platform, we are working. First is obviously the SMS. Second is all onto the app, the digital flickers which go. Third is there is a lot of mass communication which happens through our digital TV platform as soon as you open up. The last new way of working is all over. Virtual cloud. We have databases available, and there's a team. The numbers are not shared with them. They go onto a platform where the consumer is called with them. The history of a consumer comes, and we communicate to them. So every person, maybe many of the employees sitting at their home, are calling up a server, and they're doing the digital calling onto that. The new other way of looking at is there are many, many consumers who have their alternate numbers. We send communication over them. All digital communication is being done. 100% digital. There is no physical communication, no through mails. Obviously, it was earlier there. This is the way we are commuting. Digital or voice communication, ensuring that the customer is updated.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, sir. And one more question related to the productivity of the company employees, as they are working from home, so, and they are not going on field. So how you are ensuring that employees are productive enough and achieving their objectives?
I think very good question. When we moved from a physical or going on to field to a way of working which is virtual, I shared with you that we were also reinventing and we were learning. So we have many apps and different softwares which an employee does use. Onto those apps or softwares, we worked out the capability where, if I would have supposed to call up Atul Arora or I would have to visit his shop, instead of visiting today, I am calling him up. I had a conversation. I could really make it out from the length of the conversation, what kind of conversation I had with them. The number of, let's say, a TSM at a field was doing 40 visits in a day. Today, he's doing 60 calls in a day, which can be of a duration of 10 seconds or 10 minutes. And it also, the app also gives you a platform. I had this conversation with this person regarding four following things. He fills it. Then the productivity also works out in terms to, if it's a retailer, you transfer the money. You can also look at how the retailer is performing. If it's a B2B client, the payments have come or you would have given them the proposal. So the app and the software is able to catch hold of. On the daily basis, we were sharing this with our employees that you have done so many calls, you have spoken to so many customers, you have really spoken so much of valued communication has happened, and so much is not unvalued. So you need to do this to support the employees, the leadership team, the people who were mastering this, created scripts. We created the complete process. First till 10th, what is that you are supposed to do? On a daily basis, we also worked out with the employee that how he should plan the day. Working from home is not easy. Where you have interruptions or your family would be there. We would have conversations with the employees where you find that the kitchen pressure cooker blowing up a whistle, or an old mother coming and asking for help, or a child coming. We divided the day for the employee with a communication. 9:30, you would have to lock in. 10 o'clock would be a Zoom call. 10:15 till 12 o'clock, you should do this. 12:15 till 1 o'clock, you should do this. 1:30 to 2:30 is your lunch time. 2:30 to 4:30, you should do this. 4:30 to 7:30, you should do this and close the day. We all had a heart that we also knew there is a thin line of difference where an employee is into a professional world and a personal world. We did not want to breach it. We were extremely clear. We are looking for these deliverables. If you are smart enough, do this. There were many employees who came back and said, I have a kid at home. I would like to do this at this point of time. And we were extremely flexible on that.
All right. Thank you, sir. One more question related to the employee, that organizations are sending employees to the unpaid leaves, or they have reduced the salaries. So what is the good or bad strategy in this light instead of firing the employees? So although every organization is facing challenging times.
I can really come from the experience of my organization. I don't think we have done that. Point number one. But I let me be extremely honest. And you know, when I read through newspapers every day, going forward, market is going to change. There would be a lot of digitization, automation, which would happen. Adopting to the new way of working and culture is extremely important. There would be many jobs which would get redundant. But if I am right, because I speak to a lot of HR, a lot of global speakers, I have been also attending certain seminars. Many organizations are really giving a chance to employees to learn new things. So just give an example is, let's say we have a TSM who is in Jansat, which is in UP, or somebody in Bihar. He had been doing a sales job. But if he has not adopted to the digital way of working, not today, going forward, he would find himself in a very challenging scenario. Learning new things is extremely important. I go back to one of the quotes which was done, said by Sandra, who was the chief operating officer of Facebook. Today, jobs are like a corporate, corporate, I would say jungle, where you need to move within the same hierarchy and learn. Understanding from a sales to a marketing and then a consumer experience, then network, then learning new things is a part of life. Not all jobs which we were doing earlier would remain the same. So adapting to the new way of working, for this young age, I can really say that it is extremely important for learning. Keep learning the new things. This is how you would be able to really value add to yourself and to the organization. My way of looking at it in terms of is, today it is, pandemic is there, maybe there for another 6 months, 8 months, we all don't know, but the future would change. Future would change. It would be more work from home. It would be more virtual. It would be more, full of challenges because the consumer would change. The consumer behavior would change. We all would have to change according to that.
Thank you, sir. And there is common misconception in the mind of a student about the sales as a career. Because you are veteran in sales and you achieved a leadership position. So I would like to request you to throw some light that during the challenging time, how sales can be foolproof career.
During the challenging time,
sales can be a foolproof career for any management graduate for the longer period of time.
That's very interesting. When I passed out of my MBA, I also thought I was a marketing guy. So that's always a dilemma. I spent almost a 2 decades plus of my experience and almost 15 years in sales, 15 to 17 years in sales. I am not an engineer by profession, but I am a techo guy today. I've learned during the way. Talking about sales, I can say that, sales is a very chosen profession. You really need to, it is not easy. We think sales is carrying up, going to the field and really interacting to them. I have mastered in sales and marketing. There are, if you go internationally to the West world, there are organizations who, sales is not actually, let me put it, sales is not a normal job. It's a science and art. When I say science, there is a logic of doing sales. When you are into B2B sales, there is a model of doing a sales. Something to start with Spanko. What is Spanko? Suspecting, prospecting, analysis, negotiation, closing an order. When you develop the sales, you move into a more professional sales guy, a senior sales guy. When you adopt SPIN, what is SPIN? SPIN is another, it's a doctorate of sales, which is suspecting, prospecting, investing, and negotiation. Then you develop. Sales is not carrying a bag. I don't want to say that, but I'm saying that it's a very, very difficult job and a profession. The kind of attitude what you need to have sales, never say die. You need to have a conversation. You need to be a glib talker with when you're talking to who's who. When you do sales, it is not only sales that I'm going to a normal, shop market. I have been into B2B. I have been a corporate. I have handled international sales. I've done sales internationally. Today, I'm doing an Indian sales. I'm doing a distribution sales. It's a science and art. You have to mix sales with the technology, the product, how you do it. You have to mix sales, how you put your distribution. You have to put sales in front of the how you would compete with the competition. I was speaking to very senior person in HDFC Bank. So I asked him that you hire a lot of people from IIM Ahmedabad, ISBs of the world. What do they do? And I go to lectures. So very senior person of HDFC. He said, Anupam, we have all products available today. We have saving banks, credit, your overdraft limits, your FDs, moratorium, smart saving accounts, DMAT accounts, FD linked with your car and everything. What we need is somebody who can really synergize together all these products and go to the consumer. I would give a very good example of our own organization. I was into consumer experience 2 years back. Many customers use a broadband from us, but they do not use mobile from us. Somebody who uses a mobile from us does not use a DTH from us. Somebody who uses all three from us may not use Airtel services in his office. How would it be if a sales guy who's going and meeting one customer sells all three products? This is known as product line extension and really providing it to the consumer. We would have different sales guys. How can you be master of one? And when you do these sales, it is actually, today I can talk from depth to breadth of telecom technology, how does it work? You would have to really learn through that. Why? What are the attributes of the product? What, if I would have to say 60% of the CEOs have done sales across the board. Please pick it up and look at it. Sales and marketing was the backbone. I have traveled a distance. Today I'm a P&L. I take care of P&L. I'm not a finance guy, but there is somebody who can take finance. But from a market, which is actually how do you create the market? How would you develop the market? How do you nurture the market? When you learn the consumer behavior and you understand the marketing, you become a marketeer. But if you don't understand sales and you don't understand what the customer wants, marketing doesn't work out. The first principle of marketing or the first chapter of marketing itself talks about, the fifth page talks about needs, benefits, and advantages. If you do not understand the needs, benefit, and advantages, needs you get to know when you walk to a customer. Advantages you get to know when, why the customer is buying and what is the benefit of the product what you're providing. Absolutely. This is all sales. Any product, if not sold, is a product inside the industry only or the organization. This is the most important part of any organization today. And the way sales is going to change, it would be digital sales, virtual sales. There are organizations, the people who are working internationally, but are based out of today in, Agra, Bihar. These are all engineers or ISB pass outs who do virtual sales today. It is not picking up a bag and going somewhere. It is a very, very important part. One should surely have an experience of sales. Even a doctor does his sales when he pitches himself. That's why I come emotionally from a sales point of view, because what this profession can teach you with respect, not many professions would not teach you.
I agree with you, sir. So any more questions? Yeah. Last question is about Airtel Blue Jeans. So how Airtel is actually seizing this opportunity in this during challenging time? This is the last question.
Zoom has been there from last 2 years. Not many of us have used it. Yes. Post 19th March, I have seen families having a get together on Zoom. So from grandparents till the grandchild, people used to come on Zoom. That is the power of digital. From a blue jean, we ourselves use, we were using Zoom, but many of our corporate clients when they started interacting to us, they said, why does not Airtel have its own video conferencing? We were having a product known as Airtel Video Conferencing. We also provide audio conferencing. Many of the organizations even were using it for their board meetings. Finally, Verizon had this product. We partner very well with Verizon, which is based out of US. We also have our own connectivities internationally with Verizon. And they had this product. From an organization perspective, Verizon has, we worked out this blue jeans with Verizon. It is early stages, I think only 10 or 15 days. There are already hordes of requirements which have come to us. We look at actually bringing it to a platform where all micro SMEs, SMEs can use it, and then maybe really look at expanding it further.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Arpita madam, can you, Arpana madam is there?
Yes, sir. Now, yeah. Thank you so much, Anupamji, for sharing so many important aspects, starting from operations to sales. You have worked in all verticals, so you have, of course, such a rich experience that you came and shared with our students and faculty members. Thank you so much once again. So here we are at the edge of wrapping up the session. May I request Director Sir, if you would like to say a few words about the session. Okay, I think Director Sir is not here in the participants list.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay. Atul Sir, would you like to?
Yeah. So I would like to, on behalf of GLB IMR team and from the faculty members and from the students, I would like to thank you very much for Mr. Anupam Arora for giving his precious time and sharing his valuable experience with all of us. And he has given very elaborative presentation to and. To us and share his real-time life experiences, which actually not only help a student to understand operational challenges during the difficult times for how to handle them, but also to find the right opportunities in difficult time. That's a positive growth-oriented mindset. So it's very, very important session for not only for student, but for all faculty members. So on behalf of GLB, Bajaj Institute of Management and Research, I again want to thank you, Anupam sir, for giving us valuable time. And it would be great to listen to you again some other time when we will invite you in person and you can come to our campus and have a more valuable session with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to the head of department, Shankar, giving this opportunity. Just to conclude this, life is all about imparting. I respect the teachers, the kind of experience what they give. I myself been a student. Whatever I've learned, if I can impart it and you can learn from it, that is what is life about. And thank you so much for giving this opportunity. God bless you all. Take care and be safe.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, all the participants and attendees to attend the session and being a patient listener. Huge thanks to Dr. Ajay Kumar sir as well for providing us this platform for such a wonderful interaction. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
I'm closing the session now.
Mm-hmm. Yes.